And the second that whistle cuts through the air, the mist just evaporates. You see a look of annoyance on the older girl's face, and then the two children evaporate, just like the mist. Who you could probably presume is your friend Eurissa, because she has changed shapes before. You see a large half-orc maiden, Zira, and you see a stout dwarven friend of yours, Fargrim.
You picked. Don't see Milo anywhere. You picked.
You don't see Milo anywhere.
A great time to show up. Traps, killer brooms, blades and doors. We could have used you.
I'm sorry, what? Where am I?
I nudge him and flick my ear in annoyance.
Nudge me?
Yeah.
Oh, what? I don't know what traps look like. I have one answer to them, and that answer is, and she just like holds the handle of her maul, just like, that's my answer to traps.
Have you ever seen a wolf roll dice?
I have now.
You have now.
I didn't know she could shrug like that.
I scratch you behind your ears.
I'm glad you're safe. Well, you wonder what happened when the mist came in.
I thought you had gone adventuring elsewhere, but you're here.
And or now so are you.
I'm... Where is here? Because I am not where I want to be. Not that I don't want to be with you fine folk and wolf.
I like start shaking and then little by little start changing. And suddenly, I'm standing in human form.
Tiefling. Oh, your full demonic form. You guys hear from maybe about 40 feet away, you think you hear a gasp and a shutter kind of slam close.
A gasp and a what?
A shutter slamming closed.
Is there a building nearby other than the death house?
Are we just standing out in the road?
You guys are literally standing in the road in front of death house. This literally picks up the second where we left off last time. If you guys want to look at your Village of Barovia map to remind you where we are at, on the easternmost...
Absolutely.
The easternmost center crossroads there. Intersection there. Mm-hmm. There is a house that looks like it has kind of a tower up in the corner. It's on the northwest corner of the crossroads. Is everyone?
Yeah.
So I guess I'm a bit lost, but it's okay.
All right, I'm sorry. Go down.
My character right now.
Kareth, go down here to Village of Barovia map.
Yep.
Under handouts. Okay, open that up. Zoom in on that. Yeah.
No, one second. Village of Barovia map. Okay.
Okay. And then on the eastern side of the village, there's the main road that looks like it goes east-west through the center of the town.
Uh-huh.
And on the easternmost crossroads, there's the northwest corner is the house you're standing in front of.
Yep. Looks like it's got a little square with an X in the top left corner of it.
It's got a chimney on both sides of the house there. Yeah.
Yeah.
Sweet chimneys. I like chimneys.
Whoa. Chimney on both sides of the house? What color is it?
It's gray.
Gray.
Oh, gotcha. So it's chimneys on both sides and the upper left it is a tower?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, unfortunately, the map I got when I paid for the maps is not the same as the map that's in the book, which has a specific house for Death House. It's like they went in later and added the Death House to the map after the map was made. So I don't have it on this map to show you, so I'm just making which one it is.
That's
fine. Okay. You know what? I'm okay with that. I buy it. I'm sold.
I believe you that this is Death House.
All right.
I have no frame of reference.
It's at this point you also notice as you're glancing around, Milo is not there.
Where's the halfling?
I don't know. Wait. I didn't see where he went. I doubt he did either. He had no eyes.
The halfling was here?
And then it hits you that you recognize that voice of the child who bumped into you and said, excuse me.
Oh. Oh, yeah, he went that way, I guess. I think I saw him.
Milo?
You guys think you could see some little halfling shaped and sized footprints in the road, in the dust of the road.
Let's go maybe follow about, it.
They go about 10 feet to the east and then just disappear.
Probably going about his studies again.
This entire endeavor has turned out to be full of poor decisions.
That's one way of putting it.
Well,
now is the perfect time for an exposition dump, both to fill in the new player and the audience.
Hey, buddy. Indeed. So,
who would like to give the prologue? Oh, Fargrim's going.
I'll go ahead. So here's what's been going on. To catch you up, Freddy, and also kind of whoever might be watching this. I don't know if anybody is, but so we had been traipsing along, being awesome adventurers like we are, and stumbled across a gypsy caravan. Which is always a good idea to stop and drink with the gypsies. And we agreed to help them out by taking out the evil ruler that had been keeping them oppressed. And shortly after we foolishly agreed to do what they asked, these mists rolled in. And when they went away, we were somewhere else and wound up in the small Eastern European village that you've seen the map of. The mists themselves kept closing in and closing in and closing in and walling us off. We cannot go back the way we came. I tried, and it only exhausted me.
Going into the mist, not pleasant.
Yeah, not a good idea. And then when we got here, please, anybody correct me if I misremember. There were some kids standing out in front of the house. I can't remember why it is we agreed to go into the house and help them out.
They're like, their parents are hurting my brother. And you guys are like, oh, we gotta save the baby.
Oh, that's right. We had to go save the baby. And we went into the house, and the house tried to trap us and kill us.
The broom almost succeeded.
Yeah. Yeah. Surprisingly, we do great against undead ghouls. Not so great
and
against
giant
animated
mounds of rotten plants and bones. And
yeah.
Yeah, that
and
was
not so great against brooms.
Supposed to be the boss of the entire adventure, and they just backed it in the corner and kicked it while it was down the flyer.
We fucked that thing up so hard. The broom beat our ass. Giant plant thing. We raged. We just freaking, it was a mosh pit.
And everything the halfling touched knocked him out. One of the things he touched killed him, but he was brought back to life by the strange powers of this place. But he was cursed in a way that he didn't quite know, and his eyes were gone.
Yeah.
But he was alive again.
That's neat.
Then after you fought your way, after you defeated the main monster, the thing that these long dead cultists were worshiping, the house just decided, fuck it, I'm not going to play games, and it decided to directly attack you with blades swinging through doorways and poison gas from fireplaces and hordes of rats springing from the walls. But after you guys made your way out, you were met with the lord of this valley. Lord Strahd himself. He welcomed you. Pleasantries were exchanged, especially with the half-orc and the tiefling. The tiefling attempted to get his horses to gallop off and frighten them, and he just said sit, and unable to resist a compulsion she felt come over herself, the giant wolf form of Eurissa sat and waited until the carriage was out of sight and she could control herself again.
Not my proudest moment.
And then you just showed up out of the mist, Kareth.
Oh. Good times.
Yes, so welcome to nothing at all being wrong. Ever. Always.
The gypsies that you call gypsies, Fargrim, were actually Vistani.
Right. They're rebranded.
Yeah.
Rebranded.
Rebranded gypsies.
Yeah.
For legal reasons, they didn't want to have any legal action against them.
Against an entire race of people?
Yeah. You know, racial slurs and all that.
That's right. That's right. It's far more, it's far better to just rename them to something else. Sorry.
Oh, did you roll hit points, Matt, by the way?
I did.
The die that came up a 2, or the one that you can ignore that and count it as a 4, so it would have been a 3 instead.
Okay.
Because if you roll under the average of the roll, which is half plus 1, you can take the average. So you have one more hit point. So you have 16 hit points. You have little over as many hit points as Nazira had at the start of the game.
Yeah. Now,
let me give you some advice. Don't get hit with anything.
Yeah, getting hit sucks, generally speaking.
So I am not the same character as I was last time I was playing D&D, is what you're saying.
Yeah,
I'm in that role.
Yeah, that's you now. Okay. So,
but unlike the last elf like the last elf you were playing, you do notice that the stars in this place are different.
That's Born never good.
And strange, yes. At this time, you guys, you can hear a few shutters opening. People are kind of peeking out. You hear sobbing moans coming from somewhere farther into the town, drifting from some upper window somewhere.
Okay.
It's just, you just get this sense of melancholy and sadness and dread all just permeating the air.
That seems fitting.
We're still pretty wrecked from Death House, yeah? Because we haven't had a chance to rest or anything.
I thought we auto-healed because we leveled up.
Did we?
You leveled up, so I'll say your hit points went up. I'll be nice that way, but you won't get any of your abilities and stuff back yet.
Oh, we gotta frickin' rest.
Yeah.
Like now.
Perhaps we should...
In fact, as you're thinking that, if you look at the Village of Barovia map, straight to your west at what looks to be a large crossroads, you see on the south side light spilling out of a large two-story building. It's the building that kind of looks... It's on the south side here. It's got a north and south section and a little east-west section sticking off of it. It's one of the red buildings. That'll make
it's it in easy. The southeast corner of that big crossroads.
Is it the really big one, or like in the northeast or the southeast?
No. Okay, that big one that looks like it's got the two sections coming off each side. No, it's south of that.
Okay, it's the sideways fat T.
Yes, I think if we're still in this town next time we play, I'm just gonna make this a background map so I can.
You should.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. I've been trying to click and do my little purple ring, but I can't.
All right. So, I suggest we go in and attempt to find ourselves some lodging.
Sounds like a good plan to me.
You all look pretty scruffed up. I do think that would be best for you.
A rest is in order.
As you approach, you notice that a single shaft of light comes shining out of the main onto the main square. An oddly solid-looking pillar of light surrounded by heavy fog. You see a gaping doorway above which a sign hangs, and the sign proclaims that this is the Blood on the Vine Tavern.
Not ominous at all.
Not at all.
Blood on the Vine Tavern. Excellent.
Well, it seems cozy. Shall we?
I see no reason not to.
I'll just kind of grunt, nod my head inward, walk forward.
Seems like how you do anyway, so sure.
You guys stumble into the Blood of the Vine Tavern. Behind the bar, you see a large pale man in drab, colorless clothing, endlessly just wiping rags in various glasses. Not so much cleaning them as just kind of spreading the smudges around. At one table, you see three women conversing. They are all wearing the very colorful garb of the Vistani, the gypsy-like people you've met before. And then there's a man in the back at the corner, a young-looking blonde man. He looks like he's dressed in a similar style to the bartender, but he's got splashes of color kind of in his outfit. He looks a little more lively, if it were. His eyes seem to have a little more life to them. And when he sees you come in, he kind of looks up, and this look of hope fills his face.
Oh, no.
What do you guys do?
We ruin his expectations. That is what we do. But that's the long term.
What, you shit your pants right there?
Oh, if that ruins his expectations, this can go so much further south. I'm going to let the paladin lead on this one, because okay. I am not hired for HR.
Yeah, if anyone has a 13... Oh, go ahead.
No, go for it.
Okay. If anyone has a 13 or higher insight, passive insight, so 10 plus your insight, you notice that the whispered conversation the three Vistani women are having, you can't pick up entirely what it's about, but you notice as soon as you walk in, the conversation topic shifts.
Right. I do.
Their eyes are darting to you.
And I do not.
Okay. Yeah.
I do too.
So you said 13?
Yeah, 13 or higher insight. They're clearly suddenly whispering about you.
I do not notice.
I kind of like catch Fargrim's eye. I see that he notices that too.
Yeah, Fargrim gives Kareth the nod. And then, I'll quickly sidle up to Eurissa and Nazira, and point out that those two seem to have turned their topic of conversation to us. Perhaps Kareth and I should have a word with them, if you'd be kind enough to talk with our host about some place to stay.
Very well.
I'll just kind of look at Fargrim and just be like, I'll just point towards Eurissa and then turn and follow her.
These are the two best people to negotiate.
Yeah, the cast of rooms, the two people that are the most comfortable in the wild. Let's do that.
Uh, Yeah.
All right. So I apologize, Fargrim. You're going with Kareth. Did you say to the three women?
That was my intent.
Okay.
That sounds reasonable. Not that I would have much to add to a conversation about what's been going on.
As you approach the conversation, obviously, they cut it short with meaningful looks. And they put on very charming smiles as you walk by, as you walk up, and they say, "Ah, strangers from a foreign land, welcome. Can we offer you strange wares of our Vistani peoples? exotic and fascinating."
I say, no need, my good ladies. We've encountered some of your fellows before.
Ah, yes. Yes, there are many of us around here. Can we do something for you, then?
And I kind of look at Kareth and then look back. I just happened to notice that your discussion seemed to change focus as we entered. I was not sure if perhaps your people that we had met before had passed word that we were coming.
They all kind of they all actually go ahead and Kareth and Fargrim make me insight rolls. Difficulty 13. They all exchange glances. You 13. Both get that. You realize they didn't get any message of your arrival, but they all know. Oh yes, of course, yes. we heard tales of newcomers coming to our lands. I apologize, we did not realize that was you. Welcome to the Kingdom of Barovia.
Yes, welcome indeed. Thank you for the warm welcome. As we like stand there, I mean, Kareth looks okay, but the rest of us are pretty ragged. well.
Do they have anything out of habit, do they have anything valuable on them?
Are you scoping them out?
Yeah.
Are you scoping them out discreetly?
Of course. What other way is there?
Okay. Go ahead and make
perception there.
No, you're gonna notice it. I'm gonna see if they notice you notice it.
okay.
To hide the fact that you're looking, go ahead and roll me a deceit roll.
A what?
A deceit roll. Difficulty 14. Oh, hey, look at that. Okay, yeah, they each have they're wearing very nice, brightly colored, almost garish outfits with different layers and wraps and various things. However, underneath them, concealed not perfectly, you know, but if you weren't actually looking, you wouldn't notice them. They each seem to have a short sword and a hand crossbow. But they also do appear to have pouches on each of their belts.
Let's see. Okay. Just wanted to see who I was dealing with here.
And they say one woman stands up and she says, "Forgive me, I am Alenka. These are my sisters. We own this tavern. Since you are of course the visitors we've heard about, go ahead and enjoy yourselves. The first drink is on us." And she kind of nods over to the barkeep, who just kind of gives her a hollow stare and a nod.
friendly folk.
We always try to be welcoming of visitors.
Thank you very much.
These aren't acting like people who are oppressed by some despot.
No, they're not. And I'm a little wary of that. So I. Damn it, I'm a paladin.
Now you know my pain when I played a paladin in your
game. I know.
And now you know the joy I'm feeling as the GM of that.
So I kind of look at them and say, you folks seem to be warm and welcoming. Not at all what I've been led to expect from your fellows in our homeland. And I kind of emphasize in our homeland, because I think it's pretty obvious that we are not in Kansas anymore.
Yeah. Nor in Baldur's Gate.
Right.
She kind of glances at the barkeep like she doesn't, she wants to make sure he's not paying attention, and she glances at the open door, but with your insight that you can tell it's for show, and she says, she kind of lowers her voice a little bit, and she says, why wouldn't we be? We are a welcoming and loving people in this equally welcoming and loving land. And she kind of gives you, like, not quite a wink, but a look, like she's trying to convey a message. she's trying to hide something from somebody else. But you pick up, you know, though, with your insight, right, that this is all, like, it's weird layers of, you don't know if she's trying to convey something to you, she doesn't know if she's trying to want to convey something to you, like...
Right.
Yeah. Well, I apologize. With your insight, no, you know she's wanting to convey something to you,
right? So it's kind of, it sounds like one of those things where like they're not saying what they would like to be saying right now. This is an act.
But you also know that it's a show of wanting to make it look like they don't want other people to know what they're saying to you.
Right. Right.
Yeah.
I don't have any like, I don't have enough focus to be able to have this conversation. So I'll sort of give them a nod. Like, I know that there's other things going on, and say, well, I think our companions could probably are waiting for us. So you ladies have an excellent meal, and thank you again for your welcome and hospitality.
And they nod, and Alenka says, and thank you. Make sure to give our regards to Madam Ava when you see her.
Madam
nods and they sit down.
Ava, yes. Yes, of course. And then I go back over to Nazira and Yurissa. Do either of you know anybody named Madam Ava?
Before you get there, Fargrim, I'm going to cut to these guys real quick.
Yeah.
Nazira and Yurissa, you're going to go try to haggle with the barkeep?
Yeah.
That's okay. Going to go awesome.
He's a short, rotund man, and as you're approaching, he gets to the end of the line of glasses, puts the last one down, walks back over to the beginning of the line of glasses, and starts cleaning the first one again. And he just, when you get there, he just looks up and makes eye contact. His eyes widen a little bit when he sees Eurissa. And so he turns and actually he looks at Nazira first and he's like, oh, I'm not going to deal with the half-orc. And then he turns and goes, oh, maybe I am going to deal with the half-orc. And like his eyes shift back a little bit.
And when he looks at me and he makes the eye contact, I just go and just point eyes at Eurissa. which with the glare of the that doesn't really, it's like
he kind of shrinks back a little bit, but good then day, he kind of regains his composure and says, can I help you?
Yes, we are in need of some lodgings and rest.
Lodging.
Yes.
Well, we don't have bedrooms here, but we have drinks. He kind of just tiredly points over at Cass behind his shoulder. Unfortunately, there's not an inn in this town. And before I can say another word, the blonde man in the corner goes, friends, I believe I can help you. And he's like waving almost like an enthusiastic puppy, like trying to get your attention to come over to him. He's like, I can help you. I have rooms. You can rest. If you come speak with me.
Very well. I think the barkeep.
Do you want a drink?
What do I have for money?
The boss has said the first drink is free. Beer only. If you want wine, that'll cost you 1 copper.
Who's the boss?
And he nods at the three women sitting behind you that Kareth and Fargrim are currently speaking to.
She'll pull out a gold coin and just hold it between two fingers. Can you break
his eyes? His eyes widen. Says, I can get you several pitchers of wine for that.
I don't need several pitchers.
He looks like he's trying to find a way to just keep the whole coin. He's like, fine. I can't break it all the way down. I don't have that, but I can give you 1 pitcher of wine for a silver. And he snatches the coin and like starts pouring.
No. If he goes to snatch it, I'm gonna hold on with my fingers and just grab his hand as he comes in and just be like, one pitcher. 9 silver in change. Agreed.
Yes.
I'll put it down.
And it disappears like that, under a rag. And then there's a pitcher of deep crimson wine is poured. It's thick and aromatic. It's high quality wine. And it's poured in a pitcher, and he gives you 4 wooden tankards and painfully counts out 9 silver coins back to you.
And I scoop them up.
Hesitating slightly at the last one, and then he puts it down.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
And I'll grab the cups and haul them with me with the pitcher. As we go back to sit with Blondie Enthusiface.
Blondie
Enthusiface. Hi, guys. I'm over here.
Hi, Yorkie. Yeah.
And at that point, as you're turning to walk towards the table with the young man, that's when Fargrim and Kareth walk up to you and ask you if you've ever heard of anyone named Madam Ava.
Nope.
Does not ring a bell. It does it, GM.
And then you, Fargrim and Kareth, see that young man. He goes, I know of the lady of whom you speak. If you come speak with me, I can help you, please.
This doesn't seem suspicious at all.
And forgive my horrible acting. It's not quite like excited, yay, I met heroes and I'm gonna get autographs. It's more like urgent, like, oh god, finally someone can come help me. kind of excitement.
I'll meander over to him. I go nonchalant like.
He stands up and goes. There's only four chairs at the table, so he fetches another chair. And he sits down, and he seems to be the first person that hasn't stopped and stared at each and every one of you who is not human, which is all of you.
None of us are humans. That's right.
Well, one of you is a tall human with pointy ears, and one of you is a short human with a beard, but the other two are much more
obviously not human.
So I hand him my tankard.
Oh, no, please, I have my own. He holds up a cup of wine he's been drinking. You do notice there is a slight dull glassiness to his eyes as if he's been drinking already tonight, which might explain some of his over-exuberance at waving you over. He says, please, have a seat. My name's Ismark, by the way, and he holds out his hand first to Kareth.
Yes.
He pulls his hand back like he was going to shake your hand, and apparently you didn't want to.
I put my hand forward and shake.
No, his hand. I don't know this person.
He'll shake your hand. He sits down and says, "Forgive me for kind of leaping at you as soon as you entered, but you clearly aren't from around here, and I've been waiting for someone who can help. Forgive me, I'm rambling." He says, "My sister is in danger, and I need someone to help protect her."
What kind of danger?
What kind of protection?
She has fallen under the direct notice of the Lord of this valley, the Devil Strahd. He seems enamored of her. He has come twice. He has bit her neck. He has drank her blood. I'm worried what will happen to her if he gets his fangs near her again. He sent his agents to attack my house, and at this he his face darkens and he says, "A few nights ago, my father couldn't take it, and his body gave out from the stress of constant attacks from dwarves and bats and other animals of the night. I just."
He's saying dwarves.
What is her name?
No, bats and wolves.
If I dwarves.
Said
dwarves,
you said dwarves.
I said dwarves, but I'm sure you meant
dwarves. Goddamn dwarves. Dwarves, yes.
We hunted packs. Very clever.
He says the village is literally at the doorstep of his keep. Like the castle. I'm sure you all saw it up there on the cliff. That's his home. He stands there, just stares down at this village all night. If you were to take her farther away, maybe the next town, maybe to Valaki, maybe that would be too far for him to reach. Maybe she'll be safer there. I know she's not safe here. Mm-hmm. If you help me, you can come back to my home. I have beds available for rest.
Who is Kolyan?
Kolyan?
Yes. He is. And she'll kind of like look through her bag, and then she'll like just go over into Fargrim's bag and start looking through his bag and pull out a letter that we found that's written by Kolyan Indirovich. She'll pull it out and just like lay it on the table and say, and like point to the name Irina. It's on here and go, "Is this your sister?"
Yes. Where did you find that? That's from my father's handwriting.
this was in the Death House.
No, that was on the on a corpse as we were coming into.
Was it? Yeah. Oh yeah, the wargs. That's where the wargs were. Yeah, the direwolves. We found. Yeah, I'll just be blunt. Just be like, we found it on a corpse assaulted by direwolves.
My our friend, forgive her lack of tact. We made an attempt to bury and consecrate the body, but we were assaulted by the same beasts that that slew him.
I thank you for your concern, friend dwarf. Not much peace can be found here in this valley, I assure you. As it says in this letter, this place is cursed by Strahd. we can't leave. No one has been able to leave this valley for over 300 years.
Perhaps they haven't found him and hit him hard enough yet.
Many people feel that is the case.
Wait, no.
If he were killed, we would be free of this place.
Wait, we can't leave?
I tried.
There are wolves in the mist. Oh, and Fargrim suffered for it.
We're here until we solve these problems, friends.
And at this point, like, Nazira will get this look of, like, tired realization, and she'll look at Fargrim and just, like, slowly turn to Fargrim and just be like, this is that working for the greater good you always talk about, isn't it?
Nazira, someday you will learn that the greatest rewards come at the end of a journey and not while you're suffering in strange villages and malevolent houses.
The greatest rewards are delicious, get you gloriously drunk, and bring naught but glory afterwards rather than a hangover. This is not what I was promised when I left my family and my tribe. But here we are.
Indeed.
Mark is kind of just looking back and forth.
Where is this
tennis match
baron to be found? Point me in the direction of his estate. Or rather, where your sister is.
That's back at our house, my father's mansion. I can take you there.
So tell me more about this Strahd and his powers.
Ba 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 ba, GM's finding a page. He is what's called a vampire. His home is Castle Ravenloft. None who enter have ever come out alive. Every few years, villagers try to raise torch and pitchfork and storm the place, and it's never worked. In fact, last year, a man came through, a wizard of great power, and stormed the castle, and even he was cast down by the devil. He's frightening to behold. He can bend animals and people to his will. He can transform his body into a wolf or a bat. The only protection we have is that he cannot enter your house uninvited.
Well, that's something.
Does any of us have a house? Build a movable house.
At which point she will just turn and look at the not gypsy gypsies and just be like, they live in their wagons. She'll just be like,
In fact, when you look at them, Ismark says, the only people not affected by Strahd's curse who aren't bound to this land are the Vistani. They are the only people who can come and go freely. No one knows why.
Interesting. Since they're the ones that sent us here to begin with.
Sent us or brought us?
Either way, we're here now.
If you wish to meet my sister, go ahead.
So, have you noticed any weaknesses at all with this Strahd character?
It is said that vampires cannot stand sunlight, and running water burns them like fire and acid.
It's good to know. So, yes, let's...
At which point, Nazira is pulling out like a scratch of, like some paper, and she's like, fire, acid, sunlight.
Well, we'll find no more answers in this tavern, save for. And I look kind of down at the wine, half of what Nazira was after.
Yeah, at which point, like, as soon as it looks like everyone's ready to go, I didn't pour the fourth cup, and just whatever I didn't pour into the cups, I'm chugging.
it spreads nice warmth through your belly, Nazira. It is a potent, delicious wine. So Ismark says, come, he stands up and he starts to walk towards the door.
I follow.
Yeah. If you go back to your Barovian village map, the brown house all the way to the south is where he starts taking you.
Brown house
to... Wait, the brown house all the way. Give me a second. Where did that... No, it's not player's notes. Stop.
So this
person's taking us down. Oh, the monster house at the bottom with like the like 1, 2, 3, 4 chimneys.
Yeah, many chimneys. It's a mansion.
As you're walking
down that street, you do one of the houses. You hear that moaning sob again, floating through the still gray streets, and it's coming from a 2-story townhouse on that street as you're traveling south.
I look quickly.
He lowers his head and hurries on.
Yeah,
this is like, really a bummer, guys.
Dwarfy legs, like having to take an extra step for every one that he's taken, and being like, what's with that?
People are often in mourning in this town. Children, spouses go missing. It's not a happy town. And his sentence is punctuated by another racking sob that kind of echoes out through the air. Ahead of you, as you approach, you see just a worn, weary looking mansion, 2 stories squatting down. It's behind an iron, what once was a beautiful iron fence that is now rusted, vine grown over. The gates are twisting lazily off most of their hinges. And you just hear this repetitive squeal and clang as one is kind of swinging open and closed. Through that, a path leads through a weed-choked garden up to the front door. But the ground here is just churned up dirt and various things like that. And you realize it's large claw prints have torn up the grass here. And push down all the foliage around, like immediately around the house, and you see long scratch marks coming down the sides of the house as well. It looks like this place was besieged by predators.
Seem to have a dog problem.
Ismark gives you an unhappy look at that remark. He says, the wolves here. Well, there's wolves, and then there's monstrosities that dwell with them. I'm sure you've seen some.
No shortage of monstrosities here, indeed.
You notice all the windows are boarded up, and as you get inside, it doesn't look bad inside. It's well furnished. You do notice that there is a holy symbol Fargrim in every room. It is a disc with rays coming off of it, of a sun. The bottom, it's not perfectly round, but the bottom is clipped as if the sun was rising.
Okay.
And they're hastily nailed onto every wall and over every door.
Is it a symbol of a deity that I recognize?
Nope.
Nope.
You can guess the deity. I guess it seems similar to. Sam, help me with your Forgotten Lore knowledge.
Forgotten Realms.
Forgotten Realms knowledge?
Lathander? Yeah, I was going to say Lathander.
Lathander, yeah. Similar to Lathander. Similar to Lathander. Different.
I like how that's the first thing, because what, Lathander? Because it's not Lathander?
You are pulled off. You are pulled by Ismark into a side drying room, and there's a simple wooden coffin in the middle of the room. There are wilting flowers around it. A slight whiff of decay meets your nose, and you see a beautiful young woman, darker skin than Ismark. Kind of kneeling by the coffin. She's just resting her head on one corner. And she looks up as you approach, and Ismark says, please, this is my sister, Irina.
Good day, good night.
It's daytime, yeah.
Good day.
She stands and she says in a voice that sounds kind of hoarse from crying, she says, good day. I apologize. I was not expecting guests. We could have cleaned this place up a bit.
No apologies necessary. We did not expect to be guests.
I apologize if you're my brother. He tries to do good for me where it's not, and Ismark steps in. Irina, you're not safe here. We need to get you out. We need to get you to Valaki or to Kresk, one of the other towns. And they start to kind of quietly bicker back and forth. What do you do?
I look uncomfortably at everybody else. Ugh.
I'll just kind of...
They'll stop and look over at the towering half-orc.
I'll just kind of... I'll start looking around. Where did I put the letter?
I reach into my pouch and pull it out.
And she'll grab the letter. And she'll be like... She'll look at it. Irina. Show me the wound.
And she blinks in surprise, and she says, you didn't tell them, Ismark. He said, no, they found a letter that father had attempted to send out before he, and they both kind of stopped. and she gives him a look of, you know, sisterly annoyance. And she walks over. And she pulls down a scarf, and you see on the side of her neck four little holes. Two and two.
You cannot be bitten again.
What do you propose to do about it?
Well, I suppose the first question is how. I thought the master of this land couldn't enter a home without invitation.
He can't, but, and she looks kind of ashamed. She says certain powers of his can breach a threshold, causing people inside to possibly walk out.
Chains are no way to live.
And Ismark says, that's why we need to get you out of Barovia. We need to take you to the next town, out of sight of Castle Ravenloft, out of his sight. You'll be safer there.
Perhaps it will draw he or his servants out, and we can start at the bottom and smash our way to the top.
You notice Ismark doesn't seem pleased with that, but Irina has, there's a slight smile on the side of Irina's face when you say that. She stands up a little straighter. And she says, nothing would give me greater pleasure than removing that devil's head from his shoulders. But I can't leave until we...
The head won't be removed. And she'll just kind of, like, glance at the hammer. It just won't be there.
She says, I appreciate that sentiment, but I can't go anywhere until my father is laid to rest.
I'll just kind of look at the paladin and say, holy man.
Well, I suppose I am.
She says, "You're a holy man? You know the rites of the Morning Lord?"
I do not. I.
Is it Moradin or Muradin, Sean?
Moradin. I cannot claim to know the rites of your faith. I can ask for consecration from the Lord under the mountain.
So I have a quick question for you.
Yes.
Lesser restoration, if you touch a creature, you can end either one disease or one condition afflicting it. Yes. Could that apply to her?
You could always try.
Okay. Let's see, did I have any spell? I think I had spell slots left.
Have you picked your new spells yet, by the way?
That's what I'm.
Because you should have level 1 spells now.
What?
You
should
have at least one or. Don't you have any more level 1 spells now that you're level 3?
Yeah, I have 4 level 1s, 2 level 2s.
Okay.
So, yeah, I've picked the level 1s. I'm just working on the second level 2 spell. But let me check.
While you're looking at that, she'll say to Fargrim, I appreciate your thought, noble dwarf, but my father was a devout follower of the Morning Lord, and there is a priest in town and a cemetery here. I would like him to be buried and with the proper rites of him. She shrugs her shoulders. She says, no one from town is... Everyone risks retribution from Strahd. No one will help me move his body. Ismark and I can't do it.
Well, we murdered a walking pile of garbage and sludge, I suppose. Carrying a body across town isn't a terrible burden.
Maybe after a bit of rest, though, we've run into a few troubles since we came.
She nods. She says, "My father's been here 3 days. One more won't hurt."
And
let me
also, do you mind if I try some healing on you?
She looks at the dwarf. As in, can I trust this one? The one that looks like a devil?
I look at Eurissa and I say she's more trustworthy than many I've met that have no horns.
She nods and steps forward.
Besides, they're great for s'mores.
Also s'mores.
You lay your hands upon her and cast your spell.
Yeah.
And the marks shrink. Some strange pus and blood comes out, and Irina gives a pained gasp for a moment. And they reduce down, but they don't fully close. They won't bleed. They won't. There's no chance for infection. You're sure of that. But it's just, it's like these marks will never go away.
Do you feel any better?
She kind of rolls her neck and she says, "There's less pain." Thank you.
You're very welcome. I'm glad I could help.
And she just kind of. This just sigh of relief kind of escapes her, and she doesn't cry, but her eyes are swimming a little bit, and she just kind of grabs you in a hug. She's a lot stronger than she looks. Great hug.
I hug her and kind of pet her hair a little bit. Help has come. We will do what we can.
And then she kind of, you know, regains her composure, and she says, "Please let me show you to the guest chambers." And she'll grab Kareth by the hand and start leading you guys up to the second floor.
Yay, bedtime!
Why does Kareth have a face?
What?
Look at why does Kareth have a face right now? Kareth is making a confused and alarmed and angry face.
No, I'm just trying to follow along because I'm still kind of new here. I guess that's my resting elf face.
That's your resting elf face.
Resting elf face. All right. So it wasn't like an in-character face you were making. It was just player being.
No.
It was me being. Okay.
I'm a little derp right now. I've had some beer.
Oh, okay.
That's awesome.
Uh-huh.
Derp, 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 derp. Okay, I do have a question. Actually, wait, No, I think I know the answer to that. Because it says my armor class is 31. I'm pretty sure that was probably the armor class of some animal.
So. By the way, Eurissa, what's Eurissa's charisma?
Wait, that's not... Oh,
I'm sorry. What's her wisdom? I'm sorry. I said that wrong.
Wisdom is 15.
Okay. She shows you the rooms. All the rooms are kind of along the outer side. You go up the center stairs, and then just all along the outer side of the house. They've all got these wonderful large windows that open up on the balconies. Unfortunately, the windows are mostly boarded up, except for two bedrooms: Irina's bedroom and then one of the four guest bedrooms. Those are not boarded up. They still have intact, not shattered glass in them. But she'll show you to your rooms. Sean, roll a d4 for me real quick.
Roll a d4?
Yes.
Roll a d4.
I don't like it when you tell me to roll things. It's generally speaking the worst. Okay. How about a 2?
Okay. Nazira, you are given the room with the not boarded up glass double outer window doors. That's the technical exact term for them.
Ah, that's great. So hearing that there's stuff that Strahd can do that can get into a house, what is there for furniture in the room?
that's a good question.
There's a bed. There's a bed. There's a wardrobe. There is a reclining couch.
I feel like the wardrobe and the couch are going to go in front of the sweet-ass door to the outside.
Okay.
So they're like, here's your room. Awful grinding sounds. This shit gets moved around.
Yeah.
It's a Seth MacFarlane skit where it's funny, it's not funny. It's funny again.
There's a random moment where like Ismark and Irina are downstairs and they're like, "Yes, we have hope. Someone will protect us. Yay! This curse will be lifted."
And then once it's there, she'll just like do this. Take her pack off on the ground, maul next to the bed so the handle is leaning on the side table, and then just lay down on top of the blankets.
Nice.
Face first.
So night comes swiftly. You've never experienced a faster sunset. It's almost like the sun is fleeing the sky in fear. There's no pretty sunset here. It's just dark. And you guys mostly all rest quietly. Vizira, you are having trouble sleeping. It seems every time you start to get to sleep, you experience that falling sensation and jerk awake. And about the third or fourth time this happens, you hear a tapping or a scratching on the outside of the window. Rhythmic. Definitely not natural.
Let's see. What do I got? I'm going to take my cloak of protection and wrap it around my, like, my head. Just to be like, to blot out the sound. So I'm like, oh, I'm so tired. This is bullshit.
Unfortunately, it doesn't cancel it out. You still can't fall asleep with this sound. I mean, you try. An hour or two will drift by, but it just keeps going.
At this point, she's annoyed, and she's going to get up, and she's going to go into Yurissa's room, and she's just going to find a spot on the floor to throw her bedroll down and sleep on the floor.
When that happens, you do think you hear from through the cracks in the boarded up window, you think you hear a chuckle.
Is something wrong?
and then it's the grumble and like the sound of like moving around to get comfortable on the floor.
And then you both hear, I guess I will go visit Irina.
I'll get up
to go to her room.
Find her room.
Everybody's just like,
You're in the room, or are you?
Did,
you enter the room.
Did we get a full sleep though?
Not yet. You two have not got a full rest yet. And there's a distant peal of thunder. Just a kind of a soft rumble. You smell rain on the breeze, which is coming through the completely wide open glass door. And you both see Irina there with her hands on the door, and she's kind of got a fogged look in her eye, and outside you see the man who had entered the carriage just standing there.
I
do the whistle.
I'm just okay. So he's outside the window, right?
Yeah, he's outside right now.
And she's like walking towards it.
Mm-hmm.
It's okay. So in the spirit of the Olympics, javelin.
Flying tackle.
You're gonna jump into a pool of shit.
I'm gonna whip a javelin at him.
Okay.
Like she's like in one motion as she walks in and sees him. It's like pack dropped, and as it's dropping, like grab a javelin out, step, and just like, just whip the javelin at him.
Okay. Before your javelin flies though, Urissa, what was your intent of your whistle?
To see if I could break concentration or.
He looks over at you and smiles. But she still seems to be in this kind of mind fog.
Damn it, I'm useless without sleep. Kitty.
I'm going for the gold medal, Matt, with my javelin
throw. Go ahead.
Throw.
Roll your javelin throw.
I get out.
Go. Bro. 7.
Ooh, lovely.
God damn it.
It shatters the glass of the open window next to Irina, and some of the glass falls and cuts her hand. She looks down and the fog's gone from her eyes. And she looks up and she backs quickly away, like, oh shit, what was I doing here? And she backs behind you two. And Strahd kind of smiles at both of you. Says, good evening. Are you enjoying your stay in my kingdom?
At which point, I've had enough of his shit, and I just give the full-on, like, the orc heritage roar at his face with spittle and my lower fangs. I probably wake up the house.
You just shout at him from where you're at?
I just... It's just, it's fury.
Plain and simple fury.
Right. It's just, I am the fury. It's freaking, it's ours is the fury. This is House Baratheon shit right here.
And he holds up his hands. He says, whoa, friends, I merely wish to converse with you for a while. And he says, please, Nazira, come speak with me. Nazira, make me a wisdom saving throw.
Yeah, it's going to be like DC fucking 28, isn't it?
No. It's only 17.
It's only 17. I would like to spend my inspiration.
Go ahead.
Fuck.
Ow.
I mean, yeah, obviously he's just a friend who wants, well, maybe not a friend, but he's honest. He just wants to talk right now. He's being very reasonable. He is not here for violence.
I'm going to, since the window knocked her out of the fog, I'm going to wrap him on the arm with my club.
Nazira?
I would assume that as soon as he's like,
are you going to hit Nazira or Strahd?
Oh, Nazira.
Okay.
I would assume I'd be walking forward since I failed the save.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, but I can walk after
would,
you.
You're not expecting trouble, Nazira. So this is going to be kind of a surprise attack against you. Yuris, go ahead and roll your club attack. Minus Nazira's. Nazira, lower your AC by whatever your dex is.
If I can see, I can't see it, so I don't get advantage. So yeah, AC's 13 to hit.
Why am I clicking on club and nothing is happening?
I don't
know. Get an advantage.
Are you clicking on the item or the attack?
Oh right, item, attack. There we go. Never mind. Disregard.
Oop.
18.
That'll hit me.
Nazira, you take 3 damage. Go ahead and roll again with advantage.
And I'll be like, and then I'll look and just
I'm
be like,
go ahead and say, mm-hmm. until you're critical, you are immune to his gaze for 24 hours.
Nice. Fucking A right.
Okay. Sorry, friend. I had to give you a bit of a tap.
Holy man!
you guys all hear the roar, by the way, coming from this room.
Oh, yeah. Okay. I thought you were going to say you heard the roar of dwarven snores.
It's okay. I heard them.
God, dwarf.
I'm an elf. I don't sleep.
Oh, that's right. You don't.
You just remember the past, sadly, for 4 hours.
Yeah. It's a living.
Elves aren't quite so sad in D&D as they are in Burning Leaf.
No, they aren't.
Nazira's roar definitely wakes me up. Is that what I'm hearing?
Yes.
I get up and like, I guess go to the window. Are we on the? We're on the second floor. Yeah.
Yeah. You go to your window.
Yeah. Or like, I have no idea what the hell's going on right now. I just wake up and I'm like, what is?
You know the roar came from one of the rooms on the second floor. It sounds like it came from Eurysa's room.
Okay. Well, in that case, I get up and rush over that way.
Yeah. You guys are all now standing. I'm guessing Kareth runs in too.
Yeah.
Okay. Ismark comes charging in. Everyone's charging in. And you guys are all standing there, and Strahd is just smiling this charming smile out on the balcony.
Who's that?
Oh, Strahd. Forgive me. He says, he holds out his hand. I am Strahd.
Yeah, I kind of look at his hand.
They call him the devil.
I see.
Peasants have such silly superstitions. I am nowhere near so infernal.
I pull up my like the big. I mean, it's a dwarven holy symbol, so it's not like a little like nice pendant on a chain. It's like this big old freaking iron, like two
cross slave size.
Yeah, pretty much. It may as well just be a giant stopwatch. Only it's the hammer and anvil of Morden.
You beat me to it, man. So
all dwarven priests are Flava Flav. I got it.
Yes, I hold it before me and just Strahd, be gone from this place. Yeah, boy.
How does that work for turn undead for you?
Turn the unholy. As an action, you present your holy symbol and speak a prayer, censuring fiends and undead using your channel divinity. Each fiend or undead that can see or hear you within 30 feet of you must make a wisdom saving throw. If creature fails its saving throw, it is turned for 1 minute or until it takes damage.
Okay, what a wisdom saving throw?
Yes.
Difficulty?
It actually does not say. I would assume that it's my spellcasting?
Spell safety, yeah.
So that's going to be 11, so it's probably going to easily beat that. Oh, yes, yeah. Fucking...
He could have rolled low enough. That was a possibility.
Technically true. He would have had to have rolled very low.
He says... He kind of looks at it for a second and goes, huh. Apparently your god did not follow you into my realm.
Is Irina up here as well?
Yeah, and Ismark is kind of like trying to put himself between her and him, and he's got a sword in his hand. And
I can't do any spells, but I do have cantrips. So with druidcraft, I conjure this small beam of what looks like sunlight.
Okay. I'm gonna have him make a perception roll to see if that to detect if that is actually an insight roll to detect if that is true sunlight or not.
Yeah.
Trying to see if I can figure out all those bonuses.
That's
he is not trained in insight. Does not matter. All right.
Jesus Christ.
Damn it.
He only had a +2 to that roll. He rolled well. And he says, you know, no need to try to scare me away. I just came to say hello to one of my favorite playthings and again, welcome my new playthings to my realm. And he looks directly at Eurissa. He says, pleasant dreams. I mean, you remember the last dream I gave you. He smiles and then he turns and
I will there is fight you and I will crush everything about you.
He turns around and he says, I am right here, Nazira. As he speaks your name. I am right here, Nazira.
Are you so simple as to miss the message? In time.
He kind of gives a small nobleman's bow and he turns around again. And there's a brief flash of thunder where you're all momentarily blinded, and that second passes, there's just a single bat kind of squeak flying off in the distance.
So I have speak with animals. It's a spell, but as a not using a spell slot, can I just curse and bat at him?
None of us can hear sure it.
Yeah, I'll allow it.
Okay.
However, that was about 4 hours into the evening. All your sleep cycles were disrupted, except for Kareth.
Oh, what the?
Because Kareth only needs 4 hours.
You will.
GDLs.
If you wish to get a full sleep, you'll have to sleep a bit later in the morning.
I'm fine with that.
Yeah, no kidding.
GTFO.
I
need my rages back.
That's right.
I need my beauty sleep.
I can keep watch.
You guys wake up about 10 at night, or 10 in the morning. You are rested.
Yay!
Huzzah!
So happy.
I'm playing with a coin on my knuckles while you guys wake up. I'm down in the lobby or whatever, parlor, something like that.
Ismark has brought you some bread with jam spread over it. It's kind of stale. He's apologizing. He's no chef, but since the attack started, his father sent all the staff away. He didn't want anyone getting hurt if he could help it. And now since his death, no one's brave enough to come back.
Please do not worry. This is more than enough.
And he gives you all meager breakfast and asks if you are ready to help him and Irina transport the body in the light of day.
Of course.
Indeed, and perhaps afterward we should have a talk about this. What was her name? Madam Ava.
Yes, I can help you find her.
kind of back to the others. Not that I really trust the Vistani more than I could throw them.
As you step outside, you see several dozen people kind of walking around with hurried footsteps. Even though it's daylight, they don't seem to want to be outside their houses longer than they have to, running simple errands. You notice to the north of the town, there is a church with a graveyard attached. No one is heading there or coming from there. You hear the sobs again on the street, but they are quieter. As you all labor to carry this wood coffin, because there are now six of you and you all are acting as pallbearers, you escort the coffin north to the church.
Okay.
And just for visual here, let me see. I do have this one. All right. Can you guys see?
Can't see anything. It's all black.
I see black.
All right. Well, then let me help you here.
Let me tell you, if there's one phrase about Ravenloft, I'm loving it, is not one of them.
Yeah.
Oh, there we go.
Well, as a GM, I can say that I sure am.
If we get to the end of this campaign and it results in us killing Strahd, let me tell you right now how fucking satisfying that's going to be.
All right. And I don't think I have, real quick, yeah, I don't have any dynamic lighting here, so you should be able to see as far as you can see with your eyesight.
Mm-hmm. All
right. So you guys carry this up to the church, up through the front door. And you see this church is in even more disarray than the manor house was. The roof looks like it is wood with some straw over it as insulation, and part of the roof is broken and sunlight is coming in. Some of the straw is falling down. There are claw marks on the stone, some of which fresh, some of which seem to the dwarf who has stone sense or stone telling or whatever it's called, seem decades, if not centuries old. But it still appears sturdy, strong, and it's weathered it. To the back, you see a bell tower, and around the sides, you see the graveyard. Irina, though, is having you carry it straight towards the front gate. The front door of which you can see is even charred with fire. When you get there, Irina and Ismark call out for a Father Donovich, but there is no reply. What do you do?
And we've still got the coffin.
Yeah.
Perhaps.
Some of you shorter ones are maybe holding it a little more like this.
You shorter ones. I see how it is. By you shorter ones, you mean me, because there's no halfling here anymore.
So I turned to the locals. Would it be rude to go into the church without?
Not at all. I was hoping the father would help us get the door, but he must be busy in prayer. Yeah, you guys can walk in, sure. No problem.
Okay. I figure we could probably, with the six of us, handle a coffin and a door.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, if we can carry groceries inside our own houses, I think we can manage a coffin and a door.
So,
I mean, it takes some finagling, but you manage to open the door.
Without dropping the body.
Without dropping the body.
I mean, Nazira could probably hold the thing mostly alone.
The hall in front of you here is dim, smells of mildew, but farther in you see a brightly lit chapel. You see it strewn with debris. Hello. With debris and you know, cracked timbers. But you do hear a man praying inside. He is praying in common. He is praying to somebody called the Morning Lord. But before you can make out what he's praying for, you hear a scream coming from somewhere underneath the church. Oh God, I'm so hungry!
Have we come at a bad time?
After the scream, the man's praying seems to be louder and a little faster, like he's trying to pray over the scream.
I heard that. Just don't pretend we didn't hear that.
What do you do?
I'm like, shall we put down this coffin over here while we talk to the father? I ask the brother and sister, the family.
Father, please, I'm starving!
Perhaps only, is the altar cleared enough to put the coffin, or?
Looking at the altar, you do see a large, not like obese, but comfortably sized gray-haired man in priestly garments kneeling, praying at it.
So, do the brother and sister say anything?
They kind of look at each other, shocked, confused, and look at you guys.
Let's just set the coffin somewhere around here-ish and talk to the father.
Yes, I almost say something glib about the corpse not minding being set down for a moment, and then think better of it. And instead, just like kind of gesture with a foot towards a clear spot, but perhaps over here.
Okay. You guys could set it out. I'm guessing you guys are all walking in.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yes.
The man is pressing his head firmly against the altar. He's murmuring his prayer. He doesn't even hear you walk in and set the coffin down. There's another shriek that's coming up through the floorboards directly beneath you. And he just kind of like, you see him gritting his eyes closed tighter and gritting his teeth, and just his voice is hoarse. He's obviously been doing this for a long time. His throat must be parched and scratched. And he just, you hear him, you know, mumbling to the Morning Lord to help his servant.
I walk forward and just like put a hand on his shoulder.
He leaps backwards and falls over on his ass, and the Morning Lord's ring. You startled me. He says, "Forgive me, my child. I was not expecting visitors."
He said, "I don't mean to interrupt your." And I kind of look down at the floorboards. Your prayers. And then I gesture back to Irina and her brother and say, but the living need your aid.
I understand. He kind of, he looks down at the floor and it's, please, and he's very flustered, but he goes over and he grabs a cloth that's hanging around his neck. His everything about him is very soiled and dirty, and he's got stubble on his cheeks and neck. He says, yes, please, follow me. There was a plot prepared, but no one brought the body up. Come on. And he stammers and he leads you guys out, and you guys go back to the cemetery. And as he starts walking out, there's Father, please! And he just kind of flinches, but tries to just best to ignore it and keep walking out. He looks like he's about ready to start crying.
You need some food?
I'm fine, thank you.
Not for you.
He stops in his tracks and he looks through some cracks of the floor where he says, unfortunately food would not help in this case. Please, let's go bury the deceased.
What is wrong with him? He who calls to you.
And he kind of clenches his jaw like he really doesn't want to talk about it. Go ahead, Nazira, and roll a perception, or is it diplomacy? Persuasion.
There's no diplomacy anymore.
17!
That is impressive.
That is.
What just happened?
He looks at you and tears kind of start to smudge down his dirty cheeks, and he says, "That the voice you hear is my son Doru. Last year, a mage, some man with magic came through, said he could end Strahd forever, and several villagers, my son, God damn it, he was 13, believed him, and they went. Doru came back, but he's not my boy anymore. He's been cursed by Strahd with unlife. And at that, you hear from down below, I can hear more heartbeats. I know there's blood. I'm starving. And you finally realize now that this high-pitched voice isn't just high-pitched because it's screaming. It's coming from a prepubescent boy.
Ah, so that's dark.
I am sorry, Father.
I've been praying morning and night since I was able to trap him in our Undercroft. The Morning Lord... The Morning Lord can help him. The Morning Lord can fix him. But let's go bury the dead. In fact, as you're walking out, you do see through one of the broken doors, there is a trap door that has got a chain over it.
As I'll go along with getting the body buried, but I'll look over at Fargrim and raise an eyebrow.
Yeah, and just be like,
to-do list just keeps getting longer, huh?
It does. We got to stop talking to villagers. They just keep giving us quests. sorry.
Just wait till one of them goes, hey, can you get me that object from that shelf and bring it back over here? Thank you.
That's
XP.
We need you to collect 10 wolf pelts. God damn it.
We're not playing 4E, Sam. We're playing 5E. Sorry. Yes, so burying the body.
Okay, you guys go out. The ceremony is about an hour. Donovich stumbles over his words. I mean, you can tell he knows them. but obviously he's not all there. Though he seems to be doing his best to help ease Irina and Ismark's minds. And when it's done, he says a final prayer and kind of walks off on his own for a little bit under the shade of a tree. And kind of, Kareth, what's your charisma?
Let me open that up.
Actually, hang on. I apologize. He spots Fargrim's massive holy symbol and kind of nods the dwarf over.
I walk over, of course. I know how this conversation's going to go.
Not quite. I don't think. He says, so you are with Ismark. I assume he has convinced you to help his sister take her from this town.
He's certainly asked.
Well, I have to give you two pieces of advice. One, under no circumstances should you travel the roads in this land at night. Always be in a town at night. Second, he wants to take her to Valaki, and I understand that's noble, that the town has walls and is a decent militia. But if you go a little bit farther, and he actually pulls out a map and passes it to you. The map is basically the screen I showed you last time. So the main player screen, that's the village, the whole valley, that's the map you get.
Right.
He says, if you go farther to the village of Kresk, there is an abbey of St. Markovia there. She was a saint of the Morning Lord. That place is a holy temple that Strahd's evil cannot touch. She will be safe there.
How long does it take to get that?
If you travel quickly, you can get to Valakai in a day. If you travel quickly by horseback, you can get from Valakai to Kresk in a day. But it is long.
So 2 days of travel, give or take. That's... If what you say is true, then perhaps that is the best course.
May the Morning Lord go with you and your gods. Says, be with you as well.
Of course. And like after an uncomfortable moment, I say, it could be that your prayers have not gone unheard.
He kind of squints at you and try to see where you're going with this, you know.
I look back at the church and I say, you can't allow him to continue to suffer.
And he kind of gets a brief flash of hope in his eyes. Says, do you have more powerful holy magic than I? Can you restore him to life?
No.
And he looks crestfallen. And he's like, then I don't understand. How could you? And it kind of starts to real. He's like, no. He's like, no, no, no. He's like, no. The Morning Lord will help. My prayers will be at. He is my son.
And you
guys are all hearing this part of the conversation now.
Oh yeah, no. I like. I mean, I'm a dwarf, of course. So you know, I only stand so far. But like, I give him the the look that you give a doubter. And I tell him, you know, faith takes us only so far. The gods give us strength when we need it, but only to supplement our own strength. How long have you kept him down there?
he kind of looks down ashamed and doesn't say anything. Though you did hear from the people in the bar that it was not quite a year ago that mage came.
Ah, so hearing that, I can't deal with this shit anymore. And I'll walk up and stand next to Fargrim and look at the priest and say, "This town is a body to which you serve, and sometimes you must cut off the hand to save the life."
He says, "We cannot bring him life, but perhaps we can bring him peace."
I need Fargrim to roll a persuasion roll with advantage because Nazir is helping him out.
Because I'm helping! Yay!
Are you helping?
Oh, God! Oh, man, that's good.
I don't think I could roll much worse.
I didn't see the roll. Oh, yeah. He said he kind of looks at you and says, "No." And he says, I may be a foolish old man, but I know what needs to be done, but I need to get the strength for that on my own. So for now, I pray to the morning Lord.
Yep, I say then be aware that the longer he stays down there and starves, the more people you have put in danger. Not only yourself, but the people of this village.
I'm opening this door.
Did you walk back? That door's open. There's a chained, rusty chain. You guys came back and performed the rest of the ceremony in the church. So you guys are all kind of where you're sitting right now. After he talked to Fargrim, you guys kind of walked back to the church. So yeah, he's still kind of not noticed that Nazira has gone off. He's still talking to Fargrim at the moment.
I'm just gonna
the absence of a half orc.
I'm just gonna just eyeball the lock and see, kind of size it up.
It's very crude. It's rusted.
Okay. And I'm just gonna step out and look towards and just eyeball the priest past long haired dreamy McForehead over the dwarf.
Dreamy McForehead
at the priest and just say, "How long until his hunger drives him through the rusted chains?" And then she's gonna start walking this way as she talks. And he busts out and he finds whoever is here in worship, and he feeds on them and everyone here, and then he corners you, and she'll put her hand on top of this altar and rips out your throat here. Where will your morning lord be then? Let us end his suffering now. And I'm going for intimidation.
You don't say.
I will give it to you this time, because now you're intimidating instead of persuading, but I'm going to be incorporating Let It Ride into this campaign a little bit.
That's fair.
Go ahead.
I changed tactics. I'm going for getting him fucking angry. If he throws this out, so be it. But is anyone going to help me?
I'll help. I'll freaking like unloop my axe from my belt and just dunk. Put it, you know, but first onto the floor and just say, this needs to be done.
Come on.
You have failed your flock for too long.
Go. 14. I didn't hear what the DC was, but I get the feeling that wasn't enough.
It was 14.
Okay.
It was 14. And he just stares at Nazira before he finally looks away and says, "Then do what must be done, but once you leave, you are not welcome back in my church ever again. You will find no solace from Strahdar's minions here."
And Nazira's like getting ready to say something, and then just like shakes her head and turns to look at the rest of us and say, "Let's go to work." I think that is a beautiful stopping point because I'm tired.
That is a good stopping point. All right. Did you guys kill any monsters?
We killed no monsters.
No monsters. All right.
Maybe defeated a monster, this priest who let his fucking vampire kids suffer for a year.
Meanwhile, the entire village couldn't go to church.
Yeah, I just shouted him down.
I don't know what you're talking about.
By the way, there's a hashtag, quit your job in 5 words, and one of them is, "I let the dogs out."
That's pretty great.
Well, thanks for playing. Thanks for watching. If there's any watchers out there,
yeah, we
hope you enjoyed it. Thanks for being here for us, Matt.
I'll talk to you a little bit more.
And thank you for running. And I'm glad you could join us again, Freddie. We missed you.
It's good to have you, man.
Next week, same time, same channel.
Same bat time.
Pretty much.
Same bat channel. No pun intended. All right. I'm going to go ahead and end the stream here.
Please do.
All right.
All right. I got another one of the quit your job in 5 words.